Why is biblical archaeology becoming a point of interest? We're going to look at that during this program. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. More people discovering the world of biblical archaeology? Why are they studying it? Why are they finding it important in their Christian walk? Tell us your name.
Russell Moy. I'm from Berkeley, California.
And who are you with?
I'm with the Institute for the Study of Asian American Christianity.
Well, let's start.
Isaac.
Oh, fantastic. Now, Asian American Christianity.
Yes.
What does that have to do with biblical archaeology?
Well, many Asian Americans are Christian, mm-hmm. and the majority of them are evangelicals. Mm-hmm. So, of course, they're interested in the Bible, and that's why they should be interested in archaeology, because it helps enlighten and deepens our understanding of the biblical text.
Some people think, well, I start studying that archaeology, some of those archaeologists aren't necessarily believers, and they might try to disprove my faith. What's your response to that?
Well, they just let the artifacts speak for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, archaeologists are famous for fighting over interpretations. I just think that the artifacts can really help understand, illuminate the text. However, historically there has been a divide between the textual scholars versus the archaeologists. And there is now, I think, more of a coming together. There should be text and artifacts.
And when some reporter in secular media suddenly comes out with this front page story, they've discovered the tomb of Jesus, or they've discovered that Jesus was married, it shows they have no understanding of archaeology. How many people were named Jesus at the time?
Right.
And all the different things that relate to it enables people to respond to that with intelligent questions,
yeah.
doesn't it?
Yes, of course you can't identify that, you know, Jesus walked here or Jesus
yeah.
slept here,
yeah.
but it can help us deepen our understanding of the social context of Jesus and his followers. So the question is not, you know, where did Jesus walk or where did he live or die, but to understand the city where he lived, you know, the region he lived, you know, the context of his family, of his disciples. That's what archaeology can really help us understand.
How long have you been doing this?
I've done doctoral work mm-hmm. In Christian education, but primarily teaching the Bible. So I'm very interested in archaeology. So, but it's in the last few years I've developed a real interest.
Tell us
it.
About your institute in California.
It started 6 years ago, mm-hmm. and we have tried to help provide Asian American theological resources mm-hmm. for churches and seminaries. I'm one of the founding board members, and from my experience and from my other board members, unfortunately, the seminaries, both evangelical and mainline, mm-hmm. have not trained pastors, future pastors, to function effectively in Asian American churches.
Tell us what problems this presents, and what do they need to learn that they aren't learning?
Well, for example, one of the biggest misconceptions is confusing Asian Americans from Asian immigrants.
Okay.
Because we're very acculturated mm-hmm. here, but a lot of people, oh, you're Asian, and Asian, they just blew them together,
yes.
and we're just very different.
Korea, China,
yeah.
all of them.
Of course, you can't tell us apart anyway, but
yeah.
so they kind of lump us all together mm-hmm. as we're, you know, we're immigrants, you know, even though I'm third generation.
Mm-hmm.
But for a lot of people, just the way that if they first look at me, they say, oh, well, you've just been, you know, just off the boat, you know. Oh, you speak English without an accent. Oh, where are you from? You know.
Now, let's go back to archaeology for a moment. What are some of the most intriguing things that you've discovered through your studies? Things that stick out. Of course, the Dead Sea Scrolls. There's so much
yeah.
there and so many other areas.
As I heard this wonderful talk mm-hmm. Yesterday,
uh-huh.
about, oh gosh, there were so much things to learn, that the synagogues in Galilee were not, one archaeologist is arguing about dating, that they should be dated later than what they normally have. So she's trying to back up the synagogue dating two or three centuries.
Yes.
And she went, she excavated a virgin, you know, site where a synagogue was found. And lo and behold, they found a mosaic. And that's just really...
Wasn't
just
Samson happened. Portrayed in that mosaic?
Yes, Samson. Yeah, yes, you were at that you were at that
well,
session.
Well, no, I heard it. I talked to some of the people.
Yeah,
there.
Oh, she was wonderful. Jody Mogis. I can't remember.
And how Samson was portrayed almost as a messiah, but he blew it somehow.
Yeah, well, it was the picture of him tying together the tails of the foxes.
Oh, okay.
And just, it was just a wonderful story. And then the other thing is that the talk this afternoon is going to be about did Israel believe in God before the exile?
Okay.
And so how monotheism, you know, wasn't, you know, that was the official religion, but it was maybe probably not the everyday practical religion of the ordinary Israelite.
And to study this and then back up, particularly like with the Dead Sea Scrolls, and see how they line up with the scriptures that they've been writing over and over, I see a lot of affirmation of the faith.
One thing that the Dead Sea Scrolls have revealed is that there's a tremendous diversity within Judaism, just as there's tremendous diversity of early Christianity.
Yes.
So there wasn't just one.
You think of that. You think everybody agrees and just kind of moves along. They either were with God or weren't with God, and yet within that there were many, many denominations. Yeah.
There were regional Christianities that were very different.
Judaism.
Just like in Judaism, there were regional differences. And that's what archaeologists can find, is how, you know, there wasn't one monolithic, you know, Judaism or Christianity. And by excavating these specific sites, they can see the regional differences of both Judaism and Christianity.
And more Christians are exploring the world of biblical archaeology and discovering the joy that comes from such an endeavor.
How long have you been with the archaeological program?
Oh, 20 years, maybe.
And you've been following the magazine Biblical Archaeology Overview that long?
Yes, and there were, at one time, two other magazines that I followed, but now it's just this one magazine. Yes, I've been following them that long.
So what does archaeology mean to you, and how does it help you with your faith?
Well, archaeology is not something that you do to prove your faith, because you have the faith, and then the archaeology adds to the faith. It adds to knowledge about your faith. It fills it out, but it's not something that proves your faith.
So have you, while you're going through following archaeology, has it helped you build on your faith, though, by just with their findings?
Yes, because it makes the understanding of what's going on better. I understand more about it. For instance, when Jesus tells his disciples to go to the pool to find the man who is doing the water, so he can follow him back, and they can have the Last Supper at his house. Well, that man has to be an Essene, because the women are the only people that got water. Also, if you go to the John thing where the Samaritan woman is talking to Jesus, immediately when that text starts, you know that there's something different about it, because the text says it's at noon and the woman's at the well. Well, women don't go to the well at noon, because they go there in the morning and the evening when it's cooler. So the fact that that woman there is at noon immediately alerts you that this woman is something different. So those are the type of things that help me learn more once I have this background.
When they were finding the Dead Sea Scrolls and these were first coming out, what did you think of, you know, all the discoveries they were finding?
Well, you remember when they first came out, we didn't have access to the actual biblical text. What we had access to was a manual of discipline. and the other things that were non-biblical texture. So if you were able to read these other scrolls, which I did, or the interpretation of them, translation of them, that gave you a basis for understanding this community, for the people who wrote the text. So that was very enlightening. I also saw it as a bridge between the Old Testament and the New Testament, because they talked about immersion, they talked about baptism. So the idea of baptism in the New Testament had their basis for me in the Essenes and the things that we learned about from the Essenes culture from these documents that were written that we had the immediate access to.
Yeah, because the Dead Sea Scrolls, it opened my eyes to all the different sects and like all the different laws of Judaism and all that. So what did you know previous of the Dead Sea Scrolls about all of those different, how Judaism split apart before the Dead Sea Scrolls?
I truthfully did not know very much about it because I didn't know that it was that important. But one of the things, too, that the Dead Sea Scrolls illustrated for me was you had different books. You might have different versions of different books. And, you know, before you'd say, oh my, there's a mistake in the book. Well, what you learned by looking at the scrolls was that the process of copying these books from generation to generation naturally made some of the errors that we find now. So the fact that there were differences in the text really shores up the fact that the texts are good. Do you understand what I'm saying? Or
Yeah, the Dead Sea Scrolls are really amazing.
Very important to us.
My name is David Ray. I've had a passion for biblical archaeology as long as I can remember. And in recent years, largely because of interest being generated from Biblical Archaeology Review, work has revealed far more interesting things in the past 20 years than has come to light in the past 100 years.
Tell us a little about yourself. What do you do for a living?
I'm a writer, and I've written a book on called The Secret Roots of Christianity, okay. Christianity, Decoding Religious History with Symbols on Ancient Coins. I'm a numismatist. I collect coins. I interpret history through symbols on coins. And I'm a writer.
There's an awful lot that people can learn about history from coins, can't they?
There's an amazing amount that you can learn from artifacts of every kind. Artifacts are the only way we have of touching something authentically from the past and getting the feeling, the same feeling that people had who touched those originally. We can get something of that by confronting the artifacts today.
What got you moving into the world of biblical archaeology?
Just the importance of religious history to all of us.
Yes.
We grow up living, breathing, drinking, eating in an environment that's been shaped by the Bible.
When you come to conferences, is there anything particular that really strikes you, really stands out in your mind when you start studying this whole field?
Well, for me, it's the approachability of the people who are speaking, mm-hmm. the friendliness between participants. It's the feeling of collegiality that you get by attending here, and even being able to offer suggestions that sometimes throw light on information that presenters are presenting that they didn't think about previously.
It also helps you to be able to cope, perhaps, when you read an article, whether it's in a magazine or somewhere, that they discovered archaeologists that Jesus was married. Well, you find out because one archaeologist that says something like that, often there's very little evidence for just such theories. You're able to respond to things like that, aren't you?
Well, in terms of that particular controversy, I think that there's ample evidence that Jesus may indeed have been married. Mm-hmm. I think that there's far more evidence that he was married than that he wasn't.
I guess, but you can talk to that many more people that come with another side, so you got both sides on these issues.
I think that at a place like this, you do get a chance to find out what the reasons are on both sides.
Different issues
on any issue.
Mm-hmm. Does this when you see all these different variations in views and even the conclusion came to, does that affect your faith?
No, because my faith is my faith. Mm-hmm. I'm afraid, for me, having faith is something that is just part of me, like mm-hmm. breathing or eating or whatever. And then everything else is just trying to find information and figure things out.
So it doesn't challenge it or upset it? Or
for me, not in the slightest.
Mm-hmm. So you'd encourage people to engage in biblical archaeology and start doing it?
Absolutely.
How would you summarize that in one statement? What do you think?
I think it's not enough simply to feel that you have to investigate and research and find out. Mm-hmm. And you know, none of us actually uncovers the truth, but boy, it sure is fun to be part of the struggle to find it.
Hi, my name is Jim Gordon. I'm from Chicago, Illinois. I came to this conference because I'm an armchair archaeologist and specifically interested in history, religion, and biblical aspects of history.
You like, if you like church and going to church, you want to know something deeper. Mm-hmm. So that's the reason why I came here. Is you want to go deeper and find out from the experts a little bit more about your religion.
You're Philip Holt from Cincinnati, Ohio.
Right.
Okay, and you came because you want to go a little deeper.
Exactly.
You're tired of just the surface stuff.
Precisely. Mm-hmm.
How is studying archaeology helping you go a little deeper?
Well, it's not just archaeology. Mm-hmm. It's really the Bible. Mm-hmm. What I attend this particular event several times in years past. Mm-hmm. So one time I sat down with a gentleman who said, well, he had went and took Greek. Mm-hmm. So that inspired me. So after I left there, I purposely looked for a place to take Greek, mm-hmm. and then I wasn't satisfied totally, so I went and took a Hebrew. Mm-hmm. So it gave me a much deeper understanding of the scriptures. So now they want me to lead Sunday school classes mm-hmm. and that sort of thing. Yeah, exactly.
So you've been desiring to draw close to God.
Yes.
And what about the whole aspect of service, Jesus referring to, in fact, as we live out the scriptures, as we reach out to those that are in need, the poor, the needy, and yeah. how that helps us all also, not just be hearers of the word, but doers also. How do you feel that context plays in all this?
Well, I strongly believe in that mm-hmm. because we don't just do it through church, we do it through our work.
Yes.
And what we do is we have, my wife and I, we mm-hmm. we have a small business together.
Yes.
And our theme is service beyond self.
Okay.
So you might just think we're commercially interested in making money and that sort of thing. That's not it. Our big thing is to please our customers and what they want to do.
What kind of work do you do?
Marketing, advertising. Yeah, I do commercial artwork.
Uh-huh. And so even though you're commercial artwork and marketing and stuff, uh-huh. here you are studying biblical archaeology. Again, your faith, how important is that in your work?
Well, it's really, it's important to me. Mm-hmm. I feel satisfied. Mm-hmm. And there's another really selfish reason, yeah. Lawrence, and that is, who wants to go through life and go to your grave being ignorant of your relationship with God? Right. It's not going to be me.
The study of archaeology, you know, there's all kinds of views out here, all kinds of approaches, all kinds of statements, some factual, some think they're factual. Mm-hmm. How do you sort through all of that?
Well, I'm going to let the experts sort through some of those archaeological questions, yeah. but at least it verifies that it you know, that these things happened.
What do you do when you come across an archaeologist that says, for example, hey, we've got conclusive proof that Jesus was married, or here's his tomb, or that? How do you start that there?
Well, we'll just wait that out. Now, Christianity has been on the anvil for almost 2,000 years, mm-hmm. and it survived pretty well. And I think it's and God's got broad shoulders. He can take on those battles, and he'll dispense with them. If
so you don't let it shake your faith.
Not at all.
No, you know where you're coming from. So you can stand to engage in the controversy. You can look at the questions because you know where you stand.
Precisely. Mm-hmm. That's exactly right.
My name is Noah Wiener, and I'm the web editor with the Biblical Archaeology Society. I'm very happy to be working with Barr because archaeology can be a subject that often speaks to a very already archaeological audience, and a lot of the times the finds can really they can be detached from an average person's readership, and Bar has been a great magazine and a great experience to work with them because we have the very top archaeological scholars from Israel and from America traveling over, or from the whole world, working on the subject matter but writing for a popular audience. And by doing the archaeology of the biblical lands and surrounding territories, you get a lot more archaeology that people are really interested in because it still affects their daily worldview.
If people want to plug into all this through the web, how do they do that?
Well, you can go to www.biblicalarchaeology.org, and we have a multi-component website. We have a blog and a daily newsletter called Bible History Daily, mm-hmm. And I'm working on that on a daily level. We have guest contributions from some of the scholars that you'll have seen today. Mm-hmm. In addition, we have summaries of what's going into the magazine and a few other just daily news stories as their press releases coming out from the universities on a day-to-day level. We'll be getting a lot of that. Then the next portion of our website is the digital magazine, and that we have an interactive way to read the magazine as if it's on paper, and you can get it as an iPad app, and it's gotten some really good rave reviews right now. And then the biggest and part that I'm most fond of is our library. In the past, we've had three separate magazines. We had Biblical Archaeology Review, which is still running for the past 37 years. And we also had Bible Review and Archaeology Odyssey, which kind of round out the archaeological perspective, bring in more of an art history, more biblical scholarship. And all of those articles, over 6,500 articles and all their illustrations, are there in the Bass Library.
Tell everybody that website again.
www.biblicalarchaeology.org.
Okay, so they can actually go there and get a lot of information.
You can get a ton of information on from any perspective that you'd like, whether or not it's free daily articles or a full investment in the full range of scholarship, or even finding out about more travel programs like this one.
Hi, I'm Maggie Henning from Polo, Illinois. Mm-hmm. I love to come to the Bar seminars. I've been coming for over 17 years, and I really miss them when they don't come to Chicago every year. This is the first time I've been at a fest, and we're greatly enjoying it. This is my cohort in crime, Martha, behind you.
Martha, why are you in? Are you interested in this? Why?
When I taught Sunday school for 21 years, and I was always wanting to delve into it a little bit more. A Methodist, and we seem to have maybe three strands of teaching. They keep going, they repeat it every 3 years. Uh-huh. And I thought, well, there's other stories in the Bible too. So I just kind of got interested reading commentaries, and the first one I went to, I thought, I went up by myself. Uh-huh. And I'm thinking, what am I doing here? I didn't know anyone. But I met Maggie, and it was the start of something that's just been wonderful.
When you come and you learn about biblical archaeology, is there any particular thing you've picked up that really has stuck with you and enhanced your spiritual growth?
I'm just very, very interested in history, and I think it's wonderful, and I want to go back to Israel and spend a lot more time there. But I don't want to go with the rockets.
And what about you, Martha? What intrigues you?
Well, I loved listening to the scholars and how they talk about the Bible and how they gather information from the text, and I just love it. And then when I watch the Discovery Channel or Science or National Geographic and see those scholars on television, and I'm saying, gee, I've been there and I've heard them lecture, and you feel like you're on the cutting edge of information out there that most people don't get to hear. The Dead Sea Scrolls, they are amazing, and it was through Bar that I really got a lot more information on them than I would ever have gotten anywhere else.
How do you feel gathering all this information and getting a deeper knowledge of the scriptures helps thrust you into action, making a change in the world in which you live in through the love of Christ?
Well, some people think if you come to this, does it hurt your religion? And I think it just expands it and makes you think about it more, and it's never hurt my religion. It's only helped it.
Helped you to grow.
Yes, yes. And, you know, you get, now we go, there's 3-day seminars and there are week-long seminars. Uh-huh. Now, I think as the years go on, there's been less of these, which we really miss. But you're going to get a great span of different people from different walks of life. You get ministers and you get lay people like myself. You get teachers. And it's just people coming together who this is their element. And then they get together, they talk about it, and we just have a great time.
How do we move this from kind of the intellectual into the direct action? You have some thoughts on that? Because there's so much need in the world we have today.
Yeah. Well, you know, you learn that there's absolutely nothing new under the sun. Uh-huh. The scripture was right. People are terribly the same. I mean, we don't bash babies against rocks anymore, uh-huh. but it's still, man is very inhumane. Uh-huh. Fellow man.
And when we study archaeology, we also see the changes that people have made, the cultural changes that take place, and how people are letting God's love and power kind of bring about some of those changes.
True. And you know, my area is very conservative,
uh-huh, yes.
And some of the things I learn here, I don't tell the Sunday school class.
I'm talking to Mark Fairchild, and Mark, you're from Huntington University.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit, what intrigues you most about biblical archaeology?
Well, I specialize in Turkey, mm-hmm. and what's really exciting to me is most of Turkey is unexplored, and I've been to more than 250 ancient mm-hmm. cities that date back to the Greek period, the Hellenistic period, or the Roman period. Some of the cities aren't even on maps. Some of the cities are unknown by name. The Turkish people and the Turkish people have been incredibly gracious, showing me around. They like to brag about their antiquities. They don't know how to interpret their antiquities, but that's where I come in.
You're going to do a seminar on curses, pirates, and something else? What's all that about?
Well, you'll find out.
Okay,
but there was a Jewish community. I found two synagogues that have never been discovered before in Cilicia, mm-hmm. ancient Cilicia. That's where St. Paul came from.
Yeah.
It's his hometown.
Mm-hmm.
And what also was happening during the same time period, the Hellenistic period, mm-hmm. is we know that there was a strong pirate presence there in Cilicia.
Mm-hmm.
So what my presentation has to do with is how is the Jewish community reacting to the presence of pirates there? Mm-hmm.
And what do you think, as you do archaeological work in this area, you may discover, what do you think you'll find?
Well, there's a lot to be found.
Is there a lot to be
found? I'm writing a book on ancient Turkey, and I'm surprised that there's not that much that has been written. If you look at other biblical areas, Israel, Greece, Rome, Italy, you see a lot of literature, but Turkey has been closed off to the West in large part, and it's now starting to open in incredible ways. And to me, like I say, that's exciting because there's a lot that's going on. I mean, recently National Geographic exposed Göbekli Tepe, very important site that's rewriting the history books, but that's just the tip of the iceberg. I mean, it's not even the tip of the iceberg. I mean, it's just a fraction of what can be found in Turkey today.
I heard one scholar earlier present the fact that maybe Mount Ararat was not where Noah's Ark may be found.
Yeah.
Maybe found on another mountain because an olive tree couldn't maybe grow in that area.
Yeah, Judy Daw. Mark's a good friend of mine. Right. I often travel with him when I go to Turkey, and there's some substance to his argument.
And now you'll be able to explore that? I mean, they may be able to find things they hadn't found before. This is truly exciting to follow this, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. By coincidence, at Huntington University, where I teach, there's a Turkish student who lives in a small town called Silopi, which is right at the foot of Judy Daw.
Uh-huh.
And we keep talking about scheduling in such a way that the two of us can go back and maybe browse around a little bit at Judy Daw. But you've got to be careful because there's a PKK terrorist organization that's been operating in that neighborhood. Mm-hmm. The area is heavily mined, as Mark mentioned this morning. But again, that's what brings me back to Turkey. I go every year to do personal research. Mm-hmm. This year I've been there 3 times.
Wow, and if students and others wanted to link up with you?
Many times I'm asked by outside organizations to take them on tours of Turkey. At other times, it's student groups that I bring over to Turkey.
If people want to learn more about biblical archaeology, what would you recommend?
Subscribing to the Biblical Archaeological Review to begin with, because that is one of the journals that is at the forefront of exposing what's happening, what's the cutting edge of archaeology. Increasingly, we're seeing more and more articles on Turkey in the BAR, but it's going to keep people up to speed as to what's happening.
And it's exciting, the developments are unfolding. So this is a whole new field. If you want to grow in their faith, they want to find out what's going in history, biblical archaeology is the way to move, isn't it?
I would guess so.